Hi everyone, and thank you for joining us for our fifth webinar in our six-part Making Net Zero series. My name's Annalisa Bell and I'm one of E.ON's Senior Strategic Account Managers in our Industrial and Commercial Solutions business. Emissions from heat is one of the single biggest contributors to UK emissions and often makes up a significant proportion of your own business emissions. Reducing these can be challenging, so today we're going to have a look at how to decarbonise your heating and cooling in a way that produces all the right benefits for your business and the planet. I'm joined by my colleagues Alistair Hotchkiss and Michael Moggeridge, who'll be talking us through why the need to decarbonise heating and cooling, pathways to decarbonisation. We'll do a deep dive in heat pump technology and example applications. So I'll now hand over to Alistair.
Thank you, Annalisa. So my name is Alistair Hotchkiss. I am a product manager within E.ON UK, specialising in renewable heat, but with a very long background now in heat pump technology and applications. I'm going to take us a little bit along the road of why we are decarbonising and what technologies are available to help us on that journey. So why is the decarbonisation of heat and cooling so important? Well, if we look at this particular graphic, we can see that heating plays a significant part and makes a significant contribution to our total carbon emissions in the UK. And of that, industrial processes and space heating and cooling are the two single largest contributors. Now, focusing on industry itself, we can see that around about a quarter of all heat use is attributable to industry. So the opportunity to make significant inroads into this decarbonisation journey are present as we look at our industrial processes. And indeed, if we look at our non-domestic building stock, about 65% or two-thirds of it is using natural gas for its heating. And of that industrial energy consumption, about 40% is powered by natural gas. So the opportunities and the improvement potential is enormous. And we are at the start of this journey. So what are the main drivers? What's pushing us along this pathway? Well, quite clearly, as we've just said, a lot of industrial and non-domestic buildings are powered by combustion of fossil fuels, which has a direct impact on local and regional air quality. So the opportunity to improve that is enormous. As we're moving into a new energy world, the possibility to reduce costs is also significant and increasing. Traditionally, we've seen gas as a cheap way of heating. That may no longer be the case. So the opportunity to reduce costs through both direct running costs and ongoing maintenance and optimization is significant. And finally, of course, many industries, E.ON included, have made significant commitments to the reduction of carbon production and net zero achievement. And we've got to be able to show that we can do that, and we've got to be able to show how we're going to do that and demonstrate that compliance. So all of these factors are helping power us along this road of decarbonisation. So what possible ways do we have to get there? Well, there are a number. We're going to be talking about heat pumps today, but also CHP, with which I'm sure you're very familiar, powered by biofuels, offer us an opportunity. There is a significant amount of waste heat in industrial process, and that waste heat can be used to go both to generate power, but also to contribute to further and other heat demanding industrial processes. Biomass offers an opportunity to generate both heat and power. And of course, although unclear in terms of how we're going to generate the volumes, is another opportunity. Now, clearly, none of these is a silver bullet. And the future is probably going to look as a combination of these technologies. But today, we're going to focus specifically on heat pumps and the part that they can play. So why would we focus on heat pumps and why particularly now? Well, there's probably three main forces at work that are guiding us down this particular pathway. The first is the policy push. We're seeing significant and increasing changes to planning policy, which are driving the application and the uptake of low carbon technologies. And that's directly to improve local air quality. Customer intentions are increasingly significant. As we've already said, many of us are committed to implementing our net zero targets. We have commitments around the sustainable development goals. Our corporate responsibility statements are driving us, our investors and our shareholders are driving us towards better behavior in terms of energy production. And overall, there are a number of moral drivers as we understand the impact of what we do on the rest of the planet and its population. Now, government too have played their part in building incentive frameworks that are pulling us towards better behaviour. Most recently, in the world of heat, I'm sure you're all familiar with the renewable heat incentive. Now, as to how this will be developed going forward for non-domestic buildings, it's safe to say that it will have a significant part to play. BEIS too have developed their future of heat strategy, and the presence of the Industrial Energy Transformation Fund is another means to provide financial encouragement to do the right thing. And finally, we see a significant pull from the grid itself. The use of renewables means that the national grid and the generation of electricity is decarbonising over time through the application of solar farms, wind farms, and other zero and low carbon technologies. So each of these forces is at work towards why a heat pump and why now? What exactly is a heat pump? Well, simply put, a heat pump extracts or takes heat from natural sources or potentially from waste sources, natural sources such as the ground, air or water, or waste sources such as a byproduct of an industrial process or some cooling equipment. It takes that heat and using the properties of a refrigerant gas, it turns that heat from a low grade, where perhaps it isn't of any use, to a higher grade where it can be used for space heating, for domestic hot water, for sanitary purposes, or for industrial processes. So simply put, we can think of a heat pump as an amplifier. And if I wanted you to take one thing away today, it's that concept that a heat pump enables you to take something that isn't particularly useful because it's low grade and it converts it into a higher grade useful commodity. Now, heat pumps can work in reverse, so they can take heat away from something or they can deliver heat to something. And that reversibility is one of the key benefits that you're going to hear a little bit more about later. Now, it's important to recognize that heat pumps aren't new. This technology was first investigated and first developed in Victorian times. So it's the applications now and the optimization which presents us with the biggest opportunities. Now, when we talk about heat pumps, one of the most significant factors is the coefficient of performance, which is the way we describe the efficiency of a particular heat pump system. Now, simply put, the coefficient of performance is a ratio. It is the ratio of the useful energy that comes out versus the primary energy that you put in. And in this example, you can see on the right-hand side, we're delivering 3 kilowatts of high temperature useful heat by consuming 1 kilowatt of renewable electricity. And in that scenario, we would say that the heat pump has a coefficient of performance of 3. Now, coefficient of performance is not a static entity for a particular heat pump. It depends on a number of factors. It depends on the temperature that you're delivering the heat, and it depends on the temperature of your source of heat. And so one of the key design considerations is to optimize those two temperatures to make sure that we get the most efficient system. And using the graphic on the left-hand side, you can see that for different evaporating temperatures, i.e. sources of heat, the over time or over the design, we can change the efficiency of that unit by varying the input temperatures. So it's very important to choose your right output temperature, your correct input temperature, to get your most efficient and optimized system. Now I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Michael Moggeridge, and he's going to talk a little bit more about the particular applications and the benefits of using heat pump technology.
Thank you, Alistair, for an excellent overview of heat pumps and how they fundamentally work. So who am I? I'm a senior solutions developer at E.ON. So I'd be the guy that comes to your site to understand your process, understand your energy demands, and how you supply those energy demands. I then try and map out how you could do things better by deploying new technologies, but also repurposing old. I'm also a geologist, and to be absolutely honest, I love rocks a little bit too much. However, it does mean I am very comfortable with one of the biggest and most effective energy sources and storage mediums, the ground beneath your site. So what I would like you to take away from today is the following. Heat pumps have a warm and a cold side, essentially two very valuable outputs. They are not only a very low carbon technology, but they also have no on-site emissions, directly improving local air quality. Their carbon performance improves with time. As the grid gets better and decarbonizes, the heat pump gets better and decarbonizes as well. This is just a very quick slide that shows some of the processes that are covered by current heat pump temperature ranges. Some do reach 140 degrees with low COPs, but is still very useful from a carbon saving perspective. Above this, we do need to look at other technologies which Alistair touched upon. Conventional heat pump technologies will comfortably reach 90 degrees. And when you consider many industrial sites that have historically raised steam, simply do so to raise 60 degree process water across their site, meaning the steam is not fundamental to the process. Okay, so I'd just like to talk about commercial buildings. Now, if you look here at this slide, these are our Lego bricks. We have an international academy within E.ON where we brainstorm on new technologies and how to implement them into client solutions. And we use these Lego bricks to start the process of mapping out supply and demand. So going left to right, here we have the energy source, be it ground, air, or water. We then have the heat pump. And in this case, it is a heating and cooling unit, and we have a power import into it to power it. This then feeds heat into a heat store and a cool store. This allows us to load shift and ensure we can use the heat pump. We always utilize the cold side or the warm side where we can. To give a few examples of waste energy, if you have air conditioning systems, chiller processes, drying processes, refrigeration technologies, you are in effect dumping waste heat to atmosphere. If you have these, we can help you reuse that and make it into a more useful energy for your site. So some of the benefits are, and Alistair has touched upon it, simultaneous operation of heat pump maximizes unit efficiency. So for the 1 kilowatt of electricity that we input into the heat pump, we'll get 3 or 4 useful units of heat and also 3 or 4 useful units of cool. We will reduce your maintenance because the unit does 2 jobs, both heat and chill, and can also remove existing plant on site, for example, old chillers or old gas boilers. And obviously, because we're raising heat electrically, but very efficiently, we have the ability to remove gas combustion on site, which again improves local air quality. And we have the ability to use thermal stores to maximize operation times at times of favorable energy pricing. So overnight, for example, when the power price is incredibly low, we can generate and keep those stores nice and warm or cold, and then deploy that energy through the day at times that are appropriate to your process or demands. So here we're going to talk about retail, hotels and leisure. Again, reading from left to right, we have power coming from the grid to separate a heat pump and a separate chiller unit. Thermal loads are not always coincidental, so the need for simultaneous units can be far less. However, we do recognise, for example, where you may have a gym and you have a cooling demand, keeping the gym cool, you can repurpose that waste heat and warm your pool up with it, for example. However, in this solution, we do have a bore field that enables both energy supply and also inter-seasonal energy storage. The heat we were going to dump to atmosphere in the summer is actually recovered in the winter. Okay, so we're no longer dumping to atmosphere, we're dumping into the ground for recovery later. The heat pump feeds hot water and heating into the building, whilst the chiller provides cooling to the building and or refrigeration units, for example. As they do this at different times that cannot be catered for by a standard heat and cool store above ground, the ground is implemented to store the heat dumped over summer for use in the winter and vice versa. So when we're cooling the ground down through the winter, we can recover that chill and use it in the summer. So the benefits here are we are effectively reusing waste heat. We are maximizing efficiency of refrigeration by optimizing condenser temperatures on the chillers. And yet again, we're removing local combustion and improving local air quality. So with industrial applications, we can still have some pretty good solutions for you. This is slightly more complicated than the commercial and retail scenarios, but fundamentally the system still works. So I'll try and keep this quite clear, but going from right to left, we have our source of heat, water or air, and in this case, a ground store and source of energy. We then have heat recovery from chill loads, but also process heat loads, such as paint drying, for example. And this feeds into the heat pump to increase heating COP, or can be stored in the ground to be recovered at a later date. The heat and chill are delivered into large thermal stores to maximize the simultaneous operation of the heat pump, but also help deliver higher peak demands. So in effect, your thermal store acts as something of a backup and a boost to your system. The benefits here, again, we recover waste heat from processes and cooling equipment, improving overall system efficiency. We have the ability to provide process heat at required temperatures at the right place. We have the ability to use thermal stores to operate at maximum efficiency at favorable times of energy pricing. Yet again, we remove local combustion and improve air quality. In terms of what CO2 benefit do these solutions mean for all three scenarios, it is very site specific and very much depends on how you raise energy for your demands. But typically, you can expect to save more than 60% of your CO2 emissions associated with your thermal demand where combustion-based technology is displaced by a heat pump-based solution. So, addressing CHP as part of your journey. Now, there are three scenarios I'd like to discuss here. You may be someone who has a CHP working very well. However, you recognize that the CO2 emissions need to be reduced. You may have a CHP that is not working well or coming to the end of its life and want to replace it with low carbon technology. Or you may have neither. However, I have identified the clear financial benefit of a CHP as well as the carbon savings associated with the heat pump. Heat pumps can be implemented to work well with CHPs, and we are working on a 4 megawatt heat pump solution with one of our flagship district energy networks in central London. It works hand in glove with an existing CHP and chill system. So over the last 10 years, natural gas CHP has been a very popular method of realizing both CO2 and operational savings where power and heat demands were coincidental. However, as the power grid has decarbonized but natural gas grid has remained the same, the CO2 argument is unfortunately no longer valid. The savings, though, are still valid at this moment in time due to the very strong spark gap, although this may not be the case long term as taxation of power may be shifted over to gas. So therefore, the high use of system charges within the power grid may start to be moved over to the gas grid to help decarbonisation strategy. In short, solutions can be developed with both CHP and heat pumps integrated, so the CHP savings can help pay down the capital across the whole solution, whilst the heat pumps help with the long-term decarbonisation strategy of your business. Ectogrid. Now, I would like to discuss one of the most exciting developments we have been working on at E.ON, Ectogrid. Ectogrid is an infrastructure that enables the sharing of thermal energy, both heat and cool, across a site, a campus, or even an entire city quarter. It enables buildings and processes to swap thermal energy through an ambient temperature warm and cold pipe. The fundamental logic is that it is very precious about waste energy and does not let it escape the system through balancing of loads using intraday and interseasonal storage. By virtue of the ambient net temperature it operates at, it has no inherent losses and the ground becomes both a store and source of heat. To operate at maximum efficiency, we have also developed ExoCloud, which is the smart learning control systems that looks at both instantaneous and most crucially future demand to keep the system operating optimally at all times. It analyzes huge amounts of data, including historic loads, prices, and carbon intensity, and predicts what is coming down the track to get the system in the right place at the right time. Through our good neighbor system, we can set up businesses who have waste energy to repurpose it and trade for useful energy come back to them. For example, chill for supermarket refrigeration. Now, obviously, this all sounds great in theory, but the very best bit is we have built one of these at Medicon Village in Lund, Sweden. This is a zero emission energy system. So there is no combustion on site whatsoever. All of the energy is provided by heating and cooling heat pumps. They have managed to save 80% on their supplied energy. So this used to be fed by a traditional district heat network, and they've reduced the reliance on that by 80%. They have also realized a 20% net cost saving on their energy bill. And most crucially, this system is inherently expandable. So as they add buildings to their campus style development, they can be integrated very optimally into this system. So to recap, heat pumps have a warm and cold side, two very valuable outputs. They are not only very low carbon technology, but they have no on-site emissions. That directly improves local air quality. Their carbon performance improves with time. As the electricity grid gets better, the heat pump gets better. They are also superb at repurposing your waste energy back into useful energy for use in your processes or buildings. For an effective system, whatever the flavor of technology, we need to understand both the demand side along with what else is available around us to act as supply and storage. This includes minimizing losses, repurposing existing systems, exploitation of waste heat, load shifting, looking at the natural resources available, and smart controls. These are all challenges and opportunities, But by doing this, we realise both cost savings and carbon savings that materially makes a difference to a business. Now, this sounds very complicated. Clearly, there are a lot of moving parts. However, our role at E.ON is to come and map that out for you and develop a solution that suits your purpose. Now, I would like to hand you back to Annalisa.
Thank you, Michael. So there are four easy steps to start cost and CO2 savings. Firstly, we'd undertake a pre-heat survey to determine your site suitability. So what we'd really need for this would be your power and gas supply volumes, site geographic location, and a general site layout. What would be great here is if you do have your actual thermal and cost demands in half-hourly format and process temperatures. From this, we'd then undertake a desktop analysis and provide you with an indicative view of CO2 and cost savings. And if this is of interest, we'd then move on to do a more detailed site survey with our technical and design engineers. And the whole idea of this is really to work with you to firm up our assumptions and develop the best solution for your site. E.ON offer fully funded options and a full service package including all project management, installation and commissioning, and site operations and maintenance with ongoing KPIs embedded to monitor performance. So if this is of interest to you, then please contact the email address on the next page and one of our account managers will be in contact with you. So that concludes the content for today's session. And I just wanted to mention that we do have one more webinar left in our six-part Making Net Zero series, and that's on the 26th of November, Decarbonisation of Transport. So if you've not done so already and you would like to register, then again, please contact the email address on the slide now, and we can share the link to the previous webinars as well in case you've missed any of those. Thank you.